the scripture reading is Psalm 104, verses 24 to 35. O Lord, what a variety of things you have made. In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Here is the ocean, vast and wide, teeming with life of every kind, both large and small. See the ships sailing along, and the leviathan which you made in play in the sea. They all depend on you to give them food, and they need it. When you supply it, they gather it. You open your hand to feed them, and they are richly satisfied. But if you turn away from them, they panic. When you take away their breath, they die and turn again to dust. When you give them your breath, life is created, and you renew the face of the earth. May the glory of the Lord continue forever. The Lord takes pleasure in all that he has made. The earth trembles at his glance, and mountains smoke at his touch. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will praise my God to my last breath. May all my thoughts be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. Let all sinners vanish from the face of the earth. Let the wicked disappear forever. Let all that I am praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. May this bless you.
As we come to our time of prayer this morning, let us remember the missionaries in Haiti that were abducted, kidnapped, right? Is that what you said? 15 of the missionaries were kidnapped. Also, Jim Gaffigan, Noreen's husband, is in the hospital. And continue the prayers for him as well. Frank Bilger, which is Joanne Greer's father, is in the hospital as well. Robert Zimba with health issues, upcoming doctor's appointment. Then we have a lot of travel. Traveling for Megan Josh Watson in New Orleans for a wedding, flying home Tuesday. Travel for Matt Greer as he returns to college. Travel for Jeff Greer on Tuesday. People are on the move. And prayers of comfort and support for the Kiefer family in the death of Gene Kiefer. Anything that was missed? Our Heavenly Father, we are truly blessed this day. We are blessed beyond belief, knowing, O God, that you are with us no matter what is going on in our world. This day, O God, we remember those who have been kidnapped in Haiti. Lord, we pray for their safety. Lord, that you would be in their midst, Lord, and for them to have faith in that journey, Lord. May they be released and be unharmed. We pray this day for those, O God, experiencing health issues, for Jim Gaffigan, Lord, that he be healed once again and brought home. For Frank Bilger, as he too is in the hospital, Lord, we pray for wisdom for the doctors that can't figure out what's wrong, Lord. We continue to pray for George and his back, Lord, that he would get some relief so that he can return to the things that he normally enjoys doing. We lift up Robert Zimba as he is dealing with health issues as well. For Judy Garrison, dealing with some health issues. Lord, we lift up Lynn Lambert, who's facing surgery on Thursday. Lord, so many are in need of your healing touch this week, Lord. And we just pray, O God, that they will continue to have faith in that journey that they're on. This day, O God, we pray for traveling mercies for many, for Meg and Josh coming home. Lord, for Matt as he returns to school, for Jeff as he travels. Lord, many others traveling to and fro vacation, for Caitlin as she goes back to school as well. Lord, provide safety for them, Lord, and a safe travel. We thank you, O God, this day that we can surround others that need support, Lord. We pray for the Kiefer family in the death of Gene, and pray, O God, that they would have the support that's needed as they remember his life and realize the loss. We pray, O God, that you would send the helpers when needed, that you would open our eyes and our hearts and our minds to hear you call us, and then give us faith to be obedient to that call. And now, O God, we pray that you would open your word to us once again this day, Lord, that you would teach us as your disciples, and then send us forth from this place. For we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. I think you did a great job. What do you think, Gordon?
That was awesome.
That's what happens when I pick a favorite by sheer coincidence, right?
It's a mid-year hymn sing.
This morning, I want to talk about a very sensitive subject. Now, don't worry, it applies to all of us, and we all have something to learn from it. And you're already laughing, you make me feel bad. It's an unspoken rule, no matter where you go, no matter what you do. Now, I believe it probably began when we were all very, very young. Perhaps when you were in elementary school to begin with, and when you went somewhere with your parents, you probably learned from their behavior as well. Now, when you were in elementary school, where was your desk? Do you remember where you sat in the classroom? Did you have to sit alphabetically?
Yeah, sometimes.
Yeah, I was always at the end. I just automatically went to the back. Or did some classes allow you to choose your desk?
No.
Every day during the school year, you sat in the same place. Every morning you walked through the door of that classroom, you automatically went to the same desk. Your desk. Didn't you claim it for the year?
Yes.
That was your desk. It became a habit. And you may not have liked where it was, but that was not to be challenged or changed, right, when you were in elementary school. Unless you got in trouble, right? Then you got separated or got moved. You remember those times. Okay, when you got a little older and you went to the movies, where did you sit? In the back? In the front?
In the middle?
In the middle?
Depends on what you were.
Did you sit on the aisle seat or a middle seat? Even when you change theaters, do you always sit in the same, relatively same area? You may choose the seat because you can see better, or perhaps hear better, but it's more like it was closest to the bathroom or closest to the concession stand. Let's be true here. But you chose the seat where you would be most comfortable to sit for the duration of the film. You normally don't change seats once the movie starts, do you?
No.
You stay there. Now, when you get on a bus, where do you sit?
Wherever you get a seat.
Wherever you get a seat. I like that answer. The front, the middle, the back?
Front.
Do you want the window or the aisle? Do you anticipate who gets off first and want to be that person? Whatever the reason, you always choose seats in the same area. Now, if you haven't experienced this, just ask somebody that travels with Star Tours.
Oh, yes.
And you know what seats are the prime seats. Now, on Sundays, now you know where I'm going, don't you? That sacred day when you go into that sacred place that has our sacred seat. When you first enter a new church, you might experiment a little bit and go to a couple different seats, provided no one is sitting there, until you find a comfortable one. But how do you choose? Now, some will choose a seat close to where they sat with a parent or a grandparent. It just becomes part of their nature. Near the window, just in case you get bored, you have something to look at. Near the back, so you can exit quickly. Out of direct line of the pastor, just in case she calls you out. Towards the back, so you can see who else came to church, because they're all in front of you. Near the front, so you can hear better. An aisle seat, so that only one other person can sit next to you. Near the air conditioning, near the fan, so you don't get too hot. No matter the reason, when you come to church, you always sit in the same sacred seat. And if by some stroke of bad luck, someone is sitting in your seat, oh my, you stand at the back and scour the church to see if there's a replacement seat just for today. But you never are quite comfortable. So maybe next week you arrive a couple minutes earlier so you get your seat back. You know it's true. So this morning, our gospel lesson deals with sitting in a chosen seat. And do you know that sit in a chosen seat or the honored seat is mentioned 9 times in the New Testament? Listen as Jesus deals with the request of 2 of his disciples from Mark chapter 10, beginning with verse 35, the request of James and John. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Jesus. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus said. They replied, let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory. You don't know what you are asking, Jesus said. Can you drink the cup I drink? Or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with? We can, they answered. Jesus said to them, you will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. But to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared. Then the 10 heard about this. They became indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be my servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. May we learn something from these words this morning. Now, I have to confess that the very first time I read this passage, I thought, uh-oh, guys, watch out. How dare they say to Jesus, we want whatever we ask of you. That was pretty bold, wasn't it? The disciples who found out what James and John had asked of Jesus were indignant as well. But you see, they were asking, James and John were asking that Jesus, were thinking that Jesus was here to stay, that he would soon establish a temple, a place where he would sit and rule. And you know, they just wanted to be next to him, one on the right and one on the left. I wonder if they would have fought about which is which, but that's what the request was. But you see, they were thinking earthly terms, not heavenly terms. They just didn't understand yet what was going to happen to Jesus. And it's clear that the other disciples were just as confused because they got angry that James and John made the request. If they knew that Jesus would be returning to his Father, this request would not have bothered them at all. We see throughout the scripture that even those closest to Jesus did not understand that his ultimate journey on earth would end at the cross. But then again, why would they? They were used to other leaders and rulers. None of them were anything like Jesus. But they didn't know that there would be another way. When Jesus questions both James and John, they want to prove they are worthy. They make promises that they just can't keep, for they don't understand. From this, we should all understand that just because we don't fully understand the workings of Jesus doesn't mean that he casts us aside and forgets us. It just proves we are human and our knowledge is limited. When I first came to this church, I was told point blank, don't ever ask us to change our seats. Now, if you think about it, was that the most important thing that I could have been told? Just don't ask us to change our seats. Basically, I have honored that. However, when we all meet Jesus, I hope no one argues about the seats we are given. For just to be in the house of God will be more than enough for all of us.
Amen.
Amen. My prayer for all of us today is that we don't argue about the seat God is about ready to give us when we see his face. It's not so much where we sit, it's why we are in the presence of a God. Remember that we have all been chosen to be God's disciples in this place. Your seat does not matter. It only matters to you. Let us go in the assurance that God is with us and knows about all of those things. Amen.